speaker this morning, Reverend Dr. Stephen Sizer. He is the vicar of Christ Church at Virginia Water, and vicar means pastor. And when I was in England, everyone will introduce vicar so and vicar so, and I was like, what does vicar mean? I studied in USA and I had no idea. For those of you, it's a pastor. So Pastor Reverend Dr. Stephen Sizer is with us. Really, Dr. Sizer has established himself in the last 10 years as a specialty when it comes to Christian Zionism. For that sake, he didn't make many friends, but he's truly appreciated here. He has two books, and I'm sure he will speak about them today. The first one is Christian Zionism, Roadmap to Armageddon, and the second, Zionist Christian Soldiers. They are a great introduction to Zionism, Christian Zionism, its teaching, and a very sound and balanced critique of Christian Zionism. He has also some audio lectures, and you can find it in the back. And I also encourage you to visit www.stephensizers.com, his new website. It has lots of information and material. Many of it is free, so I encourage you to go there. And there are also lots of sermons. And I am used to reading Dr. Sizer for his Zionism, Christian Zionism issues, but he is also a great preacher and a very sound biblical expository preaching. We are so happy. No more introductions. Dr. Sizer, please come and speak with us. And one more thing, if you have questions, please write them down. We will have a period for Q&A after Dr. Sizer finishes.
It's a delight to be with you this morning. And it's first thing in the morning. Some of you have only been up 5-10 minutes. You may have missed breakfast. I feel really sorry for you. But we're going to do some work this morning. We're all fresh, so we're going to do some theology together. Theology in the service of peace and justice. There are three purposes for this conference. We are here to read scripture in the service of the gospel in the Palestinian context. We're here to discuss the conflict in the Holy Land from a biblical perspective. And thirdly, to encounter theologically the realities on the ground in the Holy Land. And I do urge you to get involved in all of the on-site tours and visits that we make during the conference to experience a checkpoint, for example. The title of my talk, which I was given, was The Bible, Israel, and the Church, Challenging Zionism, Anti-Semitism, and Replacement Theology. And that's my website, stephensizer.com. You can download this presentation along with others from my book, Zion's Christian Soldiers. And we are very excited that tomorrow night at 9 o'clock, we are showing a film. This will be the premiere in Palestine, and it's open to the public, and it's being advertised on the local radio stations. With God on our side. You will not want to miss this film. It is the most significant film I have watched in many, many years. And I don't say that because I had a small part in it. Porter Speakman, would you like to stand? Porter is the producer. So do talk to Porter after the session. And to whet your appetites, we're going to show you a 7-minute promotional film based on the film. So this will give you every incentive to be with us at 9 o'clock tomorrow night.
Romanticized or idealized Jewish culture.
We cannot change the past, but Christians and Jews can unite and we can control the future. 50 million evangelicals with 5 million Jewish people in North America is a match made in heaven.
So
pastor's kid, I was definitely around people who romanticized or idealized Jewish culture. We celebrated Passover. There was even a year there where we celebrated Hanukkah, which, you know, at the time, I didn't really think anything of it. But looking back, I'm not sure why we did that.
You know, I think a part of it was just the very culture and the very church culture that we grew up in, the evangelical church, that there were a couple of things that were kind of ingrained in us that we just didn't question. One was is that the children of Israel are God's chosen people. Two was those that bless Israel will be blessed by God.
Again, in Genesis 12, God gives a very clear direction to Christians, to all believers, to bless Israel. Genesis 12, verse
We'll try and find another time today to show you the promo, but something was not working there. We were not getting the sound of the film. We were getting the sound of something else with the pictures, so apologies for that. Thank you. Big thank you to our audio visual team who are doing their really very best to give you quality sound and picture. O'clock tomorrow. You won't forget, will you? Let's begin with some of the elephants that are in the room this morning. There are several elephants in the room that we don't like to talk about. And the reason we are here, as Alex hinted last night or explained last night, we're here essentially because of the impact of Christian Zionism. The Arab-Israeli conflict would not have gone on for 40, 50, 60 years were it not for the involvement of Christians in Britain in the 19th century and American Christians in the 20th and 21st century because of their one-sided support for Israel. The conflict would have been resolved long ago, but it's being perpetuated by misguided Christians today. And that's the first observation or elephant that's in the room. Alex presented a critique of Christian Zionism last night. And you will find the film tomorrow night at 9 o'clock. We'll unpack Christian Zionism and help you to understand its significance and its devastating impact today, particularly on the Christian community in Palestine. The second elephant in the room is the presuppositions which you brought with you with your luggage, because we all have presuppositions. We all bring with us baggage from the books we read as a young Christian, our pastor, our mentors, the people who have influenced us most in the gospel. And the greatest danger we face as Christians is to believe what we are taught. and not go back to the scriptures and test whether what we have been taught is consistent with the scriptures. So we all have baggage this morning. For example, if you believe that the end of the world is going to come soon in an apocalyptic war, then you are not going to worry too much about the peace process because it's not going to go anywhere. But if you believe God's mandate is that we be peacemakers, then you will see war as something negative and you will give your life to the service of peace with justice. So your presuppositions will influence what you take away from this conference. The third elephant in the room is the essential distinction between covenantalism and dispensationalism. Again, Alex presented the information on this last night, but let me summarize it down to one sentence. It's a very simple sentence, it's a question. Was the coming of Jesus the fulfillment or the postponement of the promises God made to Abraham? That will divide you into two groups. Covenantalists see the coming of Jesus as the fulfillment of the Hebrew scriptures. Christian Zionists see the coming of Jesus and the birth of the church as the postponement of those promises. John Nelson Darby said the church was a parenthesis to God's continuing purposes on earth. Dr. Gilbert Bozikian says Christian Zionism turns the church into the concubine of Christ. So, postponement or fulfillment? Zionism and anti-Semitism, that's the fourth elephant in the room. Now, it's true at various times in the past, churches and church leaders have tolerated or incited anti-Semitism and even attacks on Jewish people at Easter time of all times. Racism is a sin and without excuse. Anti-Semitism must be repudiated unequivocally. However, we must not confuse apples and oranges. Anti-Zionism is not the same thing as anti-Semitism, despite attempts by some to broaden the definition. Criticizing a political system as racist is not racist. Judaism is a religious belief. Israel is a sovereign nation. Zionism is a political system. These are not synonymous. I respect Judaism. I repudiate anti-Semitism. I encourage interfaith dialogue. I defend Israel's right to exist within borders that the international community recognizes. Israel is the only country in the world that has never defined its borders. It wants recognition, but it has never defined what its borders are. The international community knows what its borders are, but Israel has yet to recognize that. Like many Jewish people, I disagree with a political system that gives preference to expatriate Jews born in America and Europe, while denying the same rights to Palestinians born in Israel and the West Bank. Jimmy Carter is not alone in describing Zionism as a form of apartheid. And then fifthly, the fifth elephant in the room is replacement theology. It's a favorite straw man of Christian Zionists. They criticize their opponents by implying the church has replaced Israel. And the implication is that the Jewish people have ceased to have any role in the purposes of God. Now, I have yet to meet a single theologian that believes that. It's certainly repudiated by Romans 9 to 11. The scriptures are unambiguous in distinguishing, however, between the Hebrew and the Christian scriptures, between the Old and the New Covenant. Hebrews 8:13, by calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete, and what is obsolete and outdated will soon disappear. Christian Zionists will tell us, Hebrews is talking about the Mosaic covenant, not the Abrahamic covenant. But notice the writer to Hebrews says the first covenant, not the fourth covenant. Jesus in Luke 22, on the night that he was betrayed, said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." And when Jesus died on the cross, a new covenant was established with his precious blood that supersedes the basis of the old covenant. The writer to Hebrews continues, "For this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised internal inheritance the inheritance that was promised to Abraham, now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. The writer to Hebrews explains in Hebrews 11 that Abraham never experienced the fulfillment of his inheritance. Hebrews 11 says that he was looking for a better country, a heavenly one. Now the covenant, the new covenant, was not made with the church. The new covenant was prophesied in Jeremiah 31. It was made with the Jewish people. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. This was the covenant, the new covenant. Here then is the biblical basis for supersessionism. It's not a supersessionism or a succession from Israel to the church. It's the succession and the fulfillment from the old covenant to the new. And it's a one-way street. The new covenant was made in its first instance with the people of God in the Hebrew scriptures who were predominantly Jewish. And that's why Jesus initially sent his apostles only to the Jews. Matthew 10, do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. The gospel was to the Jew first, as Paul says in Romans. But when the majority of Jewish people rejected his ministry, Jesus warned them, Matthew 21, 43, therefore I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you, not maybe, but will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruit. Jesus here describes the succession that would occur within a generation. The Apostle Peter stands up after the day of Pentecost and he warns his Jewish hearers who are mocking the signs of Pentecost. Anyone who does not listen to him, that is Jesus, will be completely cut off from his people. Faith in Jesus always was the criteria for membership of God's people. Covenantalists believe that there has only ever been one people of God, whether under the Old Covenant or the New Covenant. We talk about the Old Testament church and the New Testament church. Only God knows who is numbered among the faithful remnant. That is why covenantalists are uncomfortable with describing the church as the new Israel. The term never appears in the Bible. But as we shall see in a moment, the Apostle Peter and Paul use language from the Hebrew scriptures relating to Israel and applies them to the church. 1 Peter 2, they stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, now you are the people of God. Once you have not received mercy, now you have received mercy. It is not that the church has replaced Israel. Rather, in the new covenant church, God is fulfilling the promises originally made to the old covenant church. One half of the church looked forward to the coming of Jesus. The other half looks forward to the return of Jesus. But we are one people of God. So when Jesus says to Peter, I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of death will not overcome it. The word that Jesus uses for church in Greek is translated Ecclesia. It's the same word used in the Septuagint to describe God's people in the Old Testament. So let's unpack how we should understand the relationship between Israel and the church. Who are God's chosen people? Who are God's chosen people? Well, what we're going to do in the time we have left is look at some of the paradigms used in the scriptures to describe God's people. Sand and stars, blessing and cursing, Israel in the Old Testament, Israel in the New Testament, and some of those biblical images, the vine and the branches, chosenness, the people of God, the chosen people. There is an outline, by the way, and if you haven't got one, there are some spare ones at the front. But let's begin with the first of these paradigms, these images, the sand and the stars. John Nelson Darby, one of the founders of the Brethren, along with Sarah Schofield and many of their contemporaries, John Hagee, believe that God has two separate plans, one for the church, one for Israel. It comes from Genesis 22:17, where God says, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Stars and sand. Heavenly people, earthly people. This is the view of people like Hagee and Lindsay and Welford, Schaffer, Ryrie, Schofield, way back to Darby. Darby, for example, insisted that God has a special purpose and plan for the church that will be raptured to heaven, God's heavenly people, and the Jews will remain God's chosen people on earth. And many contemporary dispensationalists see this as fulfilled in the state of Israel. John Hagee says, stars are heavenly, not earthly. They represent the church, spiritual Israel. The sand on the shore, on the other hand, is earthly and represents an earthly kingdom with a literal Jerusalem as a capital city. Both stars and sand exist at the same time. Neither has ever replaced the other. Just so, the nation of Israel and spiritual Israel, the church, exist at the same time and do not replace each other. Now, John Hagee's colorful interpretation of Genesis 22, unfortunately, falls flat on its face, because as you know, we must use scripture to interpret scripture. Around 430 BC, Nehemiah thanked God that the promises God made to Abraham had already been fulfilled. Nehemiah 9:23, you made their sons, the sons of Abraham, as numerous as the stars in the sky, not the sand on the seashore. Nevertheless, this view remains popular among evangelicals and fundamentalists in the United States. It lies behind the bestsellers like Hal Lindsey's late great Planet Earth, Tim LaHaye's Left Behind series. But while many Christian Zionists do not buy into dispensationalism, they nevertheless hold that God has a separate plan for Israel from the church. They remain God's chosen people, separate, unique, fulfilling God's covenantal purposes apart from the church. So, for example, Jews for Jesus on their website say, we believe that Israel exists as a covenant people through whom God continues to accomplish his purposes, and that the church is an elect people in accordance with the new covenant comprising of Jews and Gentiles who acknowledge Jesus. So we have two covenants in parallel, one for unredeemed Israel and the other for Jews and Gentiles who believe in Jesus. So that the promises God made in the Hebrew scriptures about Israel, Jerusalem and the temple are applied to today as if Jesus had never come. The church is a parenthesis to God's continuing purposes for Israel. It's what David Brickner says in his book, David Brickner, the CEO of Jews for Jesus Today. It's ironic that some Christian Zionists accuse people like myself of holding to a replacement theology when they themselves hold to a replacement theology where Israel has replaced the church. Secondly, let's look at blessing and cursing. The belief that God judges people, organizations, and nations on the basis of how they treat the Jewish people and the state of Israel is rooted in this promise from Genesis 12, verse 3. I will bless those who bless you, I will curse those who curse you, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. First principle of hermeneutics, who was the promise said to? Abraham. Anyone else? There's nothing in the text. It was a promise made to an individual, Abraham. A promise of blessing. But notice how the International Christian Embassy interpret the verse. This promise was given to the Hebrew patriarch Abraham. Yes, it was repeated to Jacob or Israel. So whoever blesses Israel will be blessed. Do you notice the sleight of hand? Jacob means Israel, so Israel means Israel. Israel 4,000 years ago, an individual, becomes Israel, a secular state, today. And how do we bless Israel? Give us your money. prayer finances and come to Israel as a volunteer. Bad exegesis, I suggest. The Lord is zealous, they say, for his love for Israel and the Jewish people, blesses and curses people and judges nations based upon their treatment of the chosen people of Israel. Well, if that is so, it's not based on Genesis chapter 12. Come and see the film tomorrow night and see how Hagee attempts to justify this theological framework. How do you jump 4,000 years from a promise in Genesis 12 to supporting a secular state today? Well, if you look at Scofield's Reference Bible and Shiloh English's revised New Scofield Reference Bible, they will look to Matthew 25 as a passage that teaches that God continues to bless people and nations based on their support for the state of Israel. What does Matthew 25 say? All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. The king will reply, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." And so Scofield and Shiloh English and Hagee and others say God has three separate peoples here. The sheep are the believers, the goats are the unbelievers, and the brothers and sisters are Israel. So the sheep who bless Israel will go to heaven. Those who curse Israel will go to hell. That becomes the criteria for the day of judgment, they insist. Again, there is only one small problem with this hermeneutic. It is contradicted by Jesus himself. Matthew 10, for example, Jesus describes the benefits of discipleship just before he sends out the apostles on their first training mission. He says, "If anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones, because he is my disciple, that person will certainly receive a reward." And Jesus says the blessing applies to how we treat believers. And he goes one stage further in Mark chapter 3 on another occasion. His mother and brothers are concerned about his welfare. It says he is beside himself, which means he's been in the sun too long, and they come to take him home. They're embarrassed by Jesus. And he turns to his friends. He turns to his friends and he says, "Here is my mother and my brother, for whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." Jesus clearly distinguished between a natural family and his spiritual family. The Apostle John emphasizes this in his gospel. "But as many as received him, he gave them the right to become children of God." What about Israel of God in the Old Testament? Well, there are three things I want to explain about God's people in the Hebrew Scriptures. They're very simple, it's not complicated, but when you accept it, it inevitably transforms your view of God's chosen people in the Hebrew Scriptures. The first, and this may surprise you, is that God's people in the Hebrew Scriptures were always inclusive. Always inclusive. The myth of racial purity is nothing new, nor the desire to limit or exclude those deemed inferior, whether it's colonialism, apartheid South Africa, slavery in America. We have done it for 2,000 years, and Israel's doing it today. It is surprising, perhaps, that the Old Testament knows nothing of this contemporary form of nationalism or Zionism. Instead, as we shall see, Israel as a nation was never narrowly restricted to those who were the physical descendants of the 12 sons of Jacob. Israel as a nation always incorporated people of other races and extended not just to their identity, but to their rights of residence and their inheritance of land, and their access to worship God in the temple. For example, Deuteronomy 23, in the law of Moses, God says, "Do not abhor an Edomite, for he is your brother. Do not abhor an Egyptian, because you lived as an alien in his country. The third generation of children born to them may enter the assembly of the Lord." The Edomites live today in the Negev and southern Jordan, and the Egyptians. God is saying they may enter my assembly. They can be incorporated within my people. And we know from the Exodus that many Egyptians came out with the Jewish people into the promised land. David in the Psalms says the same thing. God says through David in Psalm 87, I will record Rahab and Babylon among those who acknowledge me, Philistia too, and Tyre, along with Cush, and will say, this one was born in Zion. The Lord will write in the register of the peoples, this one was born in Zion. If the modern state of Israel was following the scriptures today, they would give Israeli passports to anyone who worshipped the one true God. Rahab with the Egyptians, Babylon as the Persians, the Iranians, Philistia the Palestinians, Tyre as the Lebanese, Cush is the Africans. Given the right of citizenship within the people of God on the basis of faith, not race. An inclusive Israel, an inclusive inheritance, as if to emphasize that citizenship means more than a new passport, God instructs the Israelites to share the land and give an inheritance to all who trust in him. Ezekiel 47, as they came out of slavery, out of Babylon, back into the land, they were instructed, you are to allot it as an inheritance for yourselves and for the aliens who settled among you. You are to consider them as native-born Israelites. Along with you, they are to be allotted an inheritance among the tribes of Israel. In whatever tribe the alien settles, you are to give him an inheritance, his inheritance. The land was to be shared. And there's a lot more we could say about this. When King Solomon did a deal with Hiram in Lebanon for the trees to help him build his temple and his home, he gave away villages in Galilee. Now, Hiram wasn't that impressed with them, but there is nothing in the scriptures that criticized Solomon for giving land away. The land was to be shared. Ezekiel 47. And then an inclusive temple. The inclusive nature of Israel extends beyond identity and inheritance to the very core of what it means to be a child of God, worship of God in the temple. God declares through the prophet Isaiah his acceptance of all nations. Let no foreigner who has bound himself to the Lord say, the Lord will surely exclude me from his people. And foreigners who bind themselves to the Lord to serve him, to love the name of the Lord and to worship him, these I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. Now Jesus cites that verse when he clears the money changers and the traders out of the temple. Why? Because the religious leaders had turned the court of the Gentiles into a market to exploit them with inflated exchange rates and exorbitant prices for sacrifices. The Israel of God in the Old Testament was inclusive of all races. It was inclusive in its inheritance and inclusive of its access to God. So let's not speak of the Hebrew people, of God's people in the Hebrew scriptures, as in any sense racially identified. What about the New Testament? Well, the inclusive nature of God's people extends into the New Testament. Those who presumed that their ancestry gave them special religious privileges are chastened. John the Baptist, you brood of vipers, he said. Who did he say that to? The people who'd come out to be baptized, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come, produce fruit in keeping for yourselves with repentance, who do not begin to save yourselves. We have Abraham as our father. For I tell you, out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. Now, God did not raise up stones for children for Abraham, but he did raise up the Gentiles, and he brought the Gentiles into the people of God to be the children of Abraham. Jesus gives a similar warning to those who try to trap him with Abraham is our father. It was clearly a mantra. Abraham is our father. If you were Abraham's children, said Jesus, probably with tears in his eyes, then you would do the things Abraham did. Jesus goes further in Matthew 8, verses 11 and 12. He praises the faith of a Gentile. He says, I haven't found faith of this kind anywhere in Israel. He praises a Gentile, Roman centurion, one of the occupying power. But then he goes on to say, I say to you, who? he's saying to those listening to him. Many will come from the east and the west, that's the Gentile nations, and will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus is warning his Jewish hearers that unless they recognize him as their Messiah, they will be excluded from the kingdom. How on earth, on the basis of these verses, can we hold it in any sense a covenant given to Abraham applies to people today apart from faith in Jesus? Let's look at one of the images that we find consistently through the scriptures that reinforces this, the vine and the branches. It is an image that we find repeatedly used in the Old Testament, Psalm 80, Isaiah 5, Jeremiah 2, Hosea 10, to describe who? Israel. But what does Jesus say? I am the vine, you are the branches. When Jesus said that was a slap in the face, he was saying, I am the vine, you depend on me, not the other way around. Jeremiah 11, Ezekiel 15, Hosea 10, Israel is the vine. No, says Jesus, you failed in your mission. You are no longer the light to the Gentiles. I am the light of the world. I am the vine.
Amen.
And what I've tried to do here is show how Paul uses the imagery of Romans 11 and Jesus uses the image in John 15 to say the same thing. Remember in Romans 11, Paul is concerned that the Gentile believers are becoming arrogant in the treatment of Jewish people and Jewish believers, because by the time the gospel had got to Rome, the majority of believers were Gentile. And it was the Jewish believers who were a minority here, not in Jerusalem, but in Rome they were a minority. And they were feeling marginalized. And so Paul has to warn the Gentile believers not to become arrogant. They are the wild branches. They have been grafted into the natural vine, and God can take them out just as easily as he put them in. And that God will one day bring back many Jewish people into that vine. But it begs the question, if we are Gentiles, into what have we been grafted? What have we been grafted into? Two separate trees or one tree? And if it's the one tree, what is the root? I am the vine, you are the branches. John the Baptist warned, the axe is already at the root of the trees. Every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. It's precisely what Jesus says in John 15. It's precisely what Peter says in Acts 3. He is warning, repentance and faith, recognition of the Lord Jesus Christ is the basis. It's always been the basis. Jesus said, Abraham rejoiced to see my day. The Hebrew scriptures are full of the faith of God's people who looked forward to their redemption. As we look back to the cross. Even more controversially, let's try and look at what does it mean to be a Jew. The Apostle Paul once described himself as a Hebrew of Hebrews, as for legalistic righteousness, faultless. Philippians 3, 5-6. Nevertheless, he refutes the notion that Jewishness can be defined by race or adherence to the law of Moses. In his letter to the Romans, he says, a Jew is not a Jew if he is one outwardly, nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. No, a man is a Jew if he is one inwardly, and circumcision is circumcision of the heart by the Spirit, not by the written code. A little later, in Romans 9, he says, for not all who are descended from Israel are Israel, nor because they are descendants are they all Abraham's children. On the contrary, it's through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. Now, remember Isaac, because he'll play an important role in a moment. In other words, it's not the natural children who are God's children, but it is the children of promise who are regarded as Abraham's offspring. So when in Romans 9-11, Paul talks about Israel, who is he talking about? He's not talking about the natural children. He's talking about the spiritual children, Jews and Gentiles who believe in Jesus. And Philippians 3, verse 3, again, Paul does something very controversial, very controversial. What's he do here? He takes the image of circumcision that identified you as a Jew. And he says, you who trust in Jesus Christ, you are the true circumcision. Circumcision not of the flesh, but of the heart. Now let's bring back Isaac. Galatians 4, if you know Galatians, you'll know it's a polemical epistle written to repudiate. The legalists from Jerusalem had come down to Galatia. They'd said, oh, Paul has only shared half the gospel with you. You need to keep the law, you need to be circumcised, and then you can be good Christians. And Paul anathematizes anything that adds law to grace. But in Galatians 4, he does something that's probably the most provocative passage in the whole of his epistles. He talks about Sarah and Hagar. In Galatians 4:25, he says, Hagar stands for Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to the city of Jerusalem because she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem that is above is free, and she is our mother. Now notice what he's going to do. He uses the image, the picture of Hagar and Sarah, and he says, you Gentiles and Jews who believe in Jesus are the children of Isaac. That's what he says. Look at what he does. He compares and contrasts those who do not believe in Jesus and those who do. He says, they are the children of Hagar, you are the children of Sarah. They are of the slave woman, you are of the free woman. They are by natural procreation, you by supernatural promise. They are the children of Ishmael, you are the children of Isaac. They are the earthly, you are the heavenly. They are in slavery, you are free. They persecute, you are being persecuted. They are excluded, you are included. They are the children of the slave woman, you are the children of the free woman. Now let me show you this diagrammatically to make it even clearer. Isaac through Sarah. Jews today. Ishmael from Hagar, Arabs today. What does Paul do? He says the legalistic Jews who reject Jesus are spiritually the children of Hagar. You who believe in Jesus are the children of Sarah. You are like Isaac. Spiritual descent is through faith in Jesus. And then he rubs it in Galatians 4 verse 30. He quotes from Genesis 21 where Sarah advises Abraham to get rid of Hagar because they can't live together as a family. And what does Paul say? Get rid of the slave woman and her son, for the slave woman's son will never share in the inheritance of the free woman's son. Therefore, apply to the Galatians, brothers and sisters, we are not children of the slave woman, but of the free woman. We can never mix law and grace. Amen. Spiritual descent is through faith in Jesus Christ. So who then are the chosen people? In the New Testament, there is not a single example, a single verse where the Jewish people are described as God's chosen people. Not one. Jesus is the chosen one, and those who follow him are God's chosen people. And I hope you've seen from the Hebrew scriptures, it's always been on that same basis. Grace through faith. Peter, in his epistle, he uses Hebrew imagery to speak to believers in the diaspora. He's not talking to one group within the Christian community, as some commentators suggest. He says to God's elect, strangers in the world, scattered who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and sprinkling by his blood. You are the chosen people, he says. And he quotes from Exodus 19, he has the audacity to take the words of Exodus 19, which apply to the Hebrew people, and he applies them to the Christians. He says, once you were not a people of God, now you are the people of God, definite article. Paul does the same thing in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11. In him we were also chosen, he says. Colossians 3, therefore as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved. Who then are God's chosen people? Those who acknowledge Jesus. We don't have time to unpack the imagery of the remnant, but I'd love to if we could, because this totally undermines the notion that you can take promises from 4,000 years ago, apply them to today, as if the coming of Jesus was irrelevant. Because as we see in Scripture, everything passes through the cross. Everything passes through the cross. So the promise made to Abraham in Genesis 12, I will bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. That's the beginning of the blessing. But then we see progressively through the Hebrew scriptures a remnant. Only a remnant survived the wilderness, the Exodus through the desert. Only a remnant came out of Babylon back into the land. So that when Jesus died on the cross, how many were left in the remnant? None. All the disciples deserted him and fled. Yes, at the cross there was his mother and some of the women and John, but did they understand what Jesus was doing? I don't think so. Isaiah 53 predicted, we all like sheep have gone astray, everyone has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. When Jesus died on the cross, the remnant was down to one, Jesus. Galatians 3, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. Scripture does not say to seeds. It's not talking about a people. He's talking about one man, one person, seed, meaning Christ. That's certainly how Paul understood it. And then what happened from that one seed? He meets with the 11. And then the 70. And he tells them to wait for the Holy Spirit. On the day of Pentecost, 3,000 are saved. Parallels remarkably the 3,000 who were slain at Mount Sinai when they wouldn't wait for Moses to come down. 3,000 are saved. Then it grows to 5,000. And then the gospel is taken to the whole world. And then we have this glorious image of the promise made to Abraham in Genesis 12, fulfilled in Revelation 7, 144,000 from the tribes of Israel, and a great multitude that no one can count from every nation, tribe, people, and language standing before the throne. This is how God's purposes are fulfilled in the world today through Jesus Christ. We must all come to God at the foot of the cross. So who are the true people of God? As we saw, John tells us, he came to his own did not receive him. To all who received him, he gave them the right to become children of God, those who believed in his name. And look at what Peter does in Acts chapter 3. He says, beginning with Samuel and all the prophets have spoken, have foretold these days. They're not talking about contemporary Israel. Peter says they're talking about the coming of Christ, the day of Pentecost, and the birth of the new covenant people. Through your offspring, all peoples on earth will be blessed. Peter says the promise made to Abraham is fulfilled today on the day of Pentecost. Ephesians 2, Paul helps us understand what God was doing in Christ on the cross. He was breaking down the wall of partition, making in himself one new humanity out of the two, making peace in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. Christian Zionists are re-erecting that barrier, just as the Israelis are building a barrier around the Palestinian ghettos. It's very profound. As you walk to the checkpoint, past the wall, by the garage, you'll find one of the slabs of rock has got this verse on that brick, on that slab. Get a photo of it. One new humanity, one body, not two, one people of God on the basis of grace through faith. And Hebrews 11, as we have this glorious image of the Hebrew saints who looked forward to the coming of Christ, we find the writer to Hebrews says, these were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. The promised inheritance had not been experienced. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. One people of God, Hebrew believers and New Testament believers, one people of God, only together with us would they be made perfect. And then in 1 Thessalonians 4, Paul says the same thing. We who are still alive will be left, will be caught up together with them. Who? Those who have died in the faith of Christ. We will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So we will be with the Lord forever. One people of God. Revelation 7, this glorious image of the promise made to Abraham in Genesis 12 fulfilled in the future, a great multitude that no one can count. This is the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Surely. Summarize, what have we found? God has only ever had one people. Citizenship of Israel was always open to all people who acknowledge God. Old Testament analogies for Israel are applied in the New Testament to the church, not to replace Israel, but to show a harmony, one people of God. God's people have always been inclusive and spiritual, not exclusive and racial. And the promises made to Abraham are fulfilled in and through the church, the Old Testament church and the New Testament church. If you want to unpack these ideas more, go to my website. You can download this text and others based on my book. And please come and watch the film. This is a resource that Porter has produced. And a number of the speakers here at the conference have participated in the making of this film. I warmly commend it to you. You can buy it today if you can't wait till tomorrow night. But please come 9 o'clock and watch it with us. And that's my earlier book, Christian Zionism, Roadmap to Armageddon. There's a question mark on both of my books, by the way. It's a question, not a statement. And this deals with the historical roots of the conflict and the political agenda of Christian Zionism today, as well as a deconstruction of their theology. And there are a number of audio and video resources you can download from my website, or you can buy them from the back. But thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Steve. And now it's time to take some questions, and let's have 20 minutes of questions. Please raise your hand and then we can take you one by one. We'll start with the gentleman here, followed by Reverend Bassam, and then the lady there, and I'll take more questions. Just wait until we get the mics. And I think you can sit here. Here.
Just a quick question for information. You mentioned that Kush is Africa, Tyre is Lebanon, I think, and who was Philistia?
Did you hear the question? Okay, can you repeat the question, please?
Just for information, you mentioned that Kush was Africa, Tyre was Lebanon, I think. Who was Philistia?
The people who lived in the... The Philistia was from what is today southern Lebanon through to Gaza. So the people living there, Palestinians,
okay.
Israelis, they would be the fulfillment of that promise today. Those who, you know, if we're talking about geographical.
Okay, thank you. And we'll have Reverend Bassam, and then the lady there, and then the bishop.
Thank you. It was wonderful. I think there's a misunderstanding when it comes to Arabs. You said Arabs are children of Ishmael. I think if we take a decent dictionary like Oxford, it will tell you an Arab is an Arabic-speaking person. Anybody who speaks Arabic is an Arab. So the majority of the people of this country, ethnically speaking, are not Arabs. The language was imposed on them. And most of the people in North Africa, even in Syria, Iraq. So there's a misunderstanding. Another thing about Philistia, I think it was Hadrian who called this land in 135, after the fail of the second Jewish revolution, he called this land Palestine. And as Christians, as people of the land, we became to be known as Palestinian Christians. We have nothing to do with the old Philistines who vanished from history in the 6th century BC. So I just wanted to make these two comments. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm happy to accept that. Thank you.
Good Good morning. That was a very stimulating talk, and I want to thank you very much for it. I'm Judith Rood. I'm a professor of history and Middle Eastern studies at Biola University in Washington, in California.
Okay. Can I bring the microphone closer?
A little closer?
Please. Yes, thank
okay.
you.
So I have a challenging set of questions for you. Okay. What about the history of the church and Jews after Pentecost, when Jews were barred from keeping their culture and identity as the price of admission to the church starting in the 4th century? The expulsion of Jews from the church over and over again, as you know. I just see this, the problem of Judaism as part of a result of the anti-Semitism that unfortunately the Jewish people have experienced even into this century. Did you know that 1/10 of the Jews who were killed in Germany by the Nazis were actually believing Protestants and Catholics?
Can you condense what you said into one short question?
Yes. What about the anti-Semitism of the church that kept Jews from being able to follow Jesus?
Anti-Semitism is appalling, and the church has acknowledged that in history and needs to be mindful of it continually. I don't know if you were in at the when I began my presentation, but I reiterated my total implacable opposition to anti-Semitism. It's a form of racism, and it's immoral, and it's inexcusable for Christians to be racist toward anyone, whether it be on the basis of their color or their racial origins. And it's very important that we acknowledge that, and I seek to do so in my presentations and my books. But what I've tried to do is show how the scripture should be understood and applied. And if we were, if we were faithful in doing so, then I don't believe that anti-Semitism would have arisen.
Thank you. Yeah. Sure.
Hello. Thank you very, very much. I'm very happy to be able to listen to you. Although I'm Swede and not English, and my English may be a little limited. You are rather fast in your thinking and all your quotations. But I very, very much appreciate that. And especially your view of the inclusiveness in the Old Testament, I think is very valid. And your criticism against the Zionism, the Christian Zionism, and so forth. I would like just to ask you, and maybe I didn't understand that correctly, if you could please elaborate a little more about replacement theology. As I understood you, you were critical against replacement theology, and so am I, of course. But when you ended up, I did not really understood that, because in the very end, it seemed to be a new replacement theology.
Okay. I think the word that a number of us would prefer to use is fulfillment theology. The promises of the Hebrew scriptures look forward to the coming of the Messiah. The Passover lamb was a paradigm of the coming lamb who would take away the sin of the world. So the promises were fulfilled in Jesus Christ and applied to all nations today. So we look back not to the church replacing Israel, and that was, I believe, the view of the Roman Catholic Church before the Reformation particularly. There was no place for Jewish people, and that's what led to anti-Semitism. It was the reformers who put the language into the language of the people, and they discovered the Jewish people. They discovered the Hebrew scriptures, they read them and realized they were historical people and that God has a purpose for them. And so many of the early reformers renewed their enthusiasm for proclaiming the good news of Jesus to Jews and Gentiles. And that gave rise to some of the early Philo-Semitic mission agencies that sought to introduce the good news of Jesus to Jewish people. So replacement theology is a straw man today. It's used to denigrate covenantalism, the idea that God has one people. I would prefer the word fulfillment. The promises were fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And there is a continuity between God's Old Testament church and the New Testament church. Hebrews, a book written for Hebrew believers, insists that together with us, they are made perfect. Their promises are fulfilled in and through Jesus. Just one more thing. You will find other verses that Zionists will pull out and say, but here's a verse about the exclusivity of God's chosen people? Or here is a promise that's unconditional and eternal and given only to the Jewish people. Now, the answer to that is to say, well, two things. When you were 5 years old or 6 years old at school, you learnt about addition and subtraction, and even numbers and odd numbers. And you learnt very soon that if you have an even number and an even number, you have an even number. If you have an even number and you add an odd number, you always have a...
And it made me think back to your lecture about the two sons, Isaac and Ismail. Mm. And that picture that you were telling about you and your brother compared to these two sons and what happened to them and how you view them.
Yes, we must stop fighting over the birthright and we must share the blessings.
Thank you. Hi, Stephen. I'm a Christian that actually believes that the return of the Jewish people to the land is part of God's plan of redemption and bringing life from the dead to the whole world. But at the same time, I pretty much agree with your summary. I work at the International Christian Embassy, by the way. You remember me, Stephen? My question is this. Romans 11 speaks about the gifts and calling that cannot be revoked, and it's clearly their reference to the Jewish people. And also, is a warning to non-Jewish believers not to be arrogant and not to be ignorant of the mystery there. Of course, you know, we can talk a long time about these things, but I just want to ask you, what is that mystery that we're not supposed to be ignorant of, and what is kind of the gist of this arrogance that he's warning about?
Thank you. Well, the mystery Paul talks about in one of the other epistles, he explains, is the mystery of the gospel that I elaborate from Ephesians 2, that God was bringing reconciliation between people groups in Jesus Christ. That was the mystery of how the promises made in the Hebrew scriptures could be fulfilled. And I tried to show that, that God's people in the Hebrew scriptures were always inclusive, and therefore the gifts and the covenants were never racially exclusive. They were for those who acknowledged the plan of redemption that God is progressively revealing, i.e. who acknowledge the one true God. So if the promises in the Hebrew scriptures were inclusive of those who acknowledge God, including those of other nations, then the way that Paul reiterates it in Romans 11 is reinforcing what he's already taught consistently in Romans, which is that God's plan is to create one new people of all nations, not exclusively Jews only.
Can I continue? Or?
One more.
Okay.
Because we need to...
All right. Well, just more specifically, though, I mean, I'd like to respond to a lot of what you said today. But the gifts and the calling there, it speaks particularly of gifts and calling that cannot be revoked.
I'm not
in
saying
the context. They are. Excuse me?
I'm not saying they are. I'm saying they are fulfilled and will be fulfilled, but they were never racially exclusive to the Jews in the first place. And therefore, how can we make them so today?
I totally agree with that, but... I don't think they were exclusive.
Okay,
and
then we're on the same page.
I think that the whole mystery here, though, which connects with life from the dead to the world, there's still something, I think, any normal reading of the Romans 11, you cannot escape. There is a distinction there. There's a warning given to non-Jewish believers.
I agree.
It's something we're not supposed to be ignorant of and concerning
not arrogant
the fulfillment.
Either. Yeah. Yep. I agree with you that God has a plan to bring many Jewish people back into the vine, into his people, but it will be on the basis of faith in Jesus Christ, not on the basis of race.
I say yes and amen.
Thank
amen.
You.
Can we talk further?
Thank you.
We can't solve Romans 9 to 11, small debate now, but you can continue later. Yes, please.
Yeah, I appreciate your conversation regarding the concerns about Christian Zionism. Two things I'd like to hear a little bit more about from you. The first one is what seems to me a collapse of Christian Zionism with Judaism, when many Jews have an issue with Christian Zionism as well, many of the criticisms you have raised, particularly in two aspects of the portrayal of Jews that I heard you giving, I may not have been your intent, The first one is this idea of race as the definition for Judaism, when that's not the case within most of Judaism. I'm not sure where that concept is coming from, so I'd like to hear a little bit more about that, since Jews can do a lie, can come to the land of Israel, even if they are a wide variety of races, and they have. And so I'm confused by what you're responding to in talking about narrowing it by race. The second thing, rather than belief, which is really the way that seems to be mostly defined. The second is a problematic portrayal of the Jews as legalistic a number of times. You talked about not jumping 4,000 years. It seems that taking the portrayal of Jews in the Gospels and in the New Testament as the definition of Jews today has its issues, and I'd like to hear a little bit more on that. And the third thing is, once we come to one people, what happens, you know, and that the basis for salvation comes through belief in Jesus Christ. I guess my own beliefs are different in the sense that I can see God having several children. And not what happens with Muslims, what happens with other religious traditions with this definition that salvation again becomes exclusively through Jesus Christ.
Thank you. And just to clarify, we'll have two more questions and that's it.
Okay, very, very quickly on that last one. Clearly, God knows what has happened, but God knows what would have happened and will happen. Jesus in the Gospels pronounces judgment on some of the northern towns on the Sea of Galilee for rejecting him. And he says, woe unto you, Chorazin, for if the miracles I performed had been performed in Sodom and Gomorrah, they would have repented long ago. Therefore, it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for them than it will be for you. Jesus appealed to knowledge of what would have happened as well as what had happened. And therefore, we must trust in his hands those who have not heard the gospel and those who have heard a distortion of the gospel, because God knows what would have happened had they heard about Jesus as we have. So we must trust them into his hands. But the urgency is that the gospel is not pie in the sky when you die, it's life now. And therefore the incentive and motivation to share the love of Christ now is that people come into his family knowingly and willingly in this life. I'm not quite sure what your question was at the beginning, but the gentleman at the back who talked about nationalism and nations then and now is helpful, I think, because modern Zionism is a modern political movement that bears little or no relationship to Jewish identity before the modern era. For example, in Acts 1, the apostles asked Jesus, are you now going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Now, Calvin says there are more errors in that question than there are words. They hadn't got the Holy Spirit yet. They were still thinking about national identity, but it's interesting that they identified Israel as existing without the land. Israel existed without national sovereignty. Will you now restore the kingdom to Israel? Israel exists, but it's not got sovereignty. So at least in the Hebrew scriptures, in the early Christian church, they understood that they were Israel, even though they didn't have national sovereignty. So we need to make sure we're distinguishing between people and a political system.
Thank you, we need to move on. Yeah, we need to move on. We're actually almost, thank you. Yeah, please. And if you're limited to one question, please.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. The thing I wanted to say and ask you to comment on was about really the dichotomy, I think, that's at the heart of the problem that you identify in Christian Zionism. Is that in a sense it's you still come back to an exclusive covenant with the church, or the one people, which of course is one of the problems we have in the church, that not all of us will go along with that in the way the others will, i.e. how you view salvation through Christ. Now, the danger for people like me is that we might stop preaching the gospel because we want to say nobody is excluded. And I don't want to do that. But one of the things that I've found when I've come to Israel and Palestine and heard about the issues and the theology is really the issue of contextualization. Because let me take the example of anti-Semitism that was raised earlier, and you know, rightly said, you utterly reject it. But anti-Semitism comes from taking the context in which words were said at the early church, which said the Jews are outcasts. Mm. So it does have its roots in the context of a forming church. And the problem with literalism is that if you read that and you say, that's true for all time, it's not just to do with the context, is that it does form the foundation for nasty beliefs.
Yes, that's very helpful.
Thank you.
The essential error that the church made, or Christians have made, who have mistreated the Jewish people, is to focus on who killed Christ rather than who did Christ die for. Mm. Christ died for the Jewish people. He died for the world. And therefore, if God so loved the world, loved the Jewish people, that he sent his only son to die in their place, how can we mistreat them? And so it's not surprising that many Jews repudiate Christian Zionism. Gershon Gorenberg does in his End of Days, says we're act three in a four-act play. You know, you love us, but you're going to mistreat us one day. You know, we're going to get nuked in a war of Armageddon. So they're quite skeptical about Christian Zionism. But the other thing I want to say is we've got to distinguish within Christian Zionism. It's not a monolithic movement. As I show in my other book, Christian Zionism, there are at least three strands. There are the evangelistic Christian Zionists whose primary mission is the gospel and proclaiming Jesus, but feel either for pragmatic reason or because they are Jewish in origin, they love Zion and they out-Zion the Zionists. And that's a statement on Jews for Jesus' own website. Now, I don't have much issue with that strand of Christian Zionism because they are committed to the gospel and they are seeking to proclaim the good news of Jesus among Jews especially. The second strand is the apocalyptic Christian Zionists, and they write the books and they make a lot of money from the gloom and doom agenda, Hal Lindsey, Tim LaHaye, and others. And that's the most influential. They write the books, tens of millions of copies, and they have their views about the future have jaundiced a large proportion of the church in America particularly. The third strand are and they believe they're going to shock people into the kingdom. You know, tell them what's going to happen in the future, and then they'll repent. The third strand are the political pragmatic Christian Zionists, people like Kufi, John Hagee, and others who do not share the good news of Jesus with Jewish people. They believe that they're saved by virtue of the covenants or by virtue of their origins. And their role as Christian Zionists is to bring the people into the land. So they talk about fishing for Jesus and being fishermen, not in terms of sharing the gospel, but in terms of bringing people back to the land. So you've got at least three strands. The political pragmatists are the ones in Washington who lobby Congress, lobby the Senate, and they have distorted the gospel the most. The ones in the middle are focusing on end-time prophecy rather than the gospel. So you must bear in mind that there are different strands within the movement.
Thank you. And one more question, and then we conclude.
The simple question is whether there is any biblical significance of the return of the Jews to Zion. I'm thinking of, it's not for your sake, O Israel, that I'm about to act. You've been profaning my name among the nations. But, and here comes the telling phrase, that the nations may know that I am the Lord. Isn't this a question of their not just returning to the land, but to their Lord, Jesus? Hmm. I'm a Norwegian Lutheran. I read Luther's commentary on Genesis chapter 12. He says, who are the children of Abraham? The most natural thing, looking at history and looking at our scriptures, is Jews. But that can't be, because if the Jews were intended, we would expect to see them back in their own land. We would expect to see them having an Obrigkeit, a state of their own, but that's not what we see. We see them living among us, scattered and despised. What if Father Luther had been alive today?
That's a very important question. you know, what is the significance of modern Israel today? And you quoted an important passage on that. I'm agnostic on the degree to which God has been active or passive in the return of the Jews to the land. In terms, you know, if this was 1947 and we were holding a conference, I would be lobbying for somewhere safe and secure for the Jewish people after the Holocaust. 50, 60 years on, we're calling for a safe, secure, independent, sovereign, contiguous state for the Palestinians. My concern about using scripture to justify the return of the Jews to the land is that consistently the message from Moses right through the prophets was the same. Choose this day between two paths. Obey and you can stay in the land. Rebel and you are out of the land. It was always the same, consistently. Not once do we have a promise that in rebellion you can come back to the land. It's always through faith. And therefore, I'm skeptical about the belief that in any sense the prophets are being fulfilled in the return of the Jews to the land. I would go as far as to say, unless we see a radical transformation in the attitude of Israeli society towards Palestinians and the acknowledgement of the consensus that there must be either a two-state solution or a one-state that's fully democratic, I would expect an exile from the land if I believe the warnings of the prophets, not a return. An exile from the land would be more consistent if we're going to take the prophets seriously about the warnings and promises.
Thank you very much for the question. Thank you, Dr. Sizer. Please accept a small gift from Dr. Bishop. Just to show our appreciation for Dr. Sizer. Whoa, that was intriguing.